Here's your primetime president and co-founder, Alan Tommy Cooper.
Well, praise God. Tommy and I welcome you to this program, which I believe people are going to find very, very interesting.
Oh, it is. You probably would like to set your recorder. Even if you will be around to watch it, you want to set your recorder. We have the privilege of having Jim and Penny Caldwell, Split Rock Research Foundation, Diamond Head, Mississippi. And they have the most incredibly fantastic story. And I'm not going to steal any of your thunder, guys, but thank you for sending me your book. I can't wait to hear about it in person. And you have been on an incredible journey for several years.
She wouldn't even let me talk to her while she was reading it.
So
where shall we start?
Tell us about yourselves first.
Okay. Well, we are oh so happy to be here. We thank you so much for having us. It is a real blessing to be able to come and sit down and talk with you. We have come up all the way from deep south Mississippi here to Texas, and but we're bringing a story to you from all the way on the Arabian Peninsula, because there are some amazing things that are being uncovered there in our day and time, and we are only so blessed to have been able to be a part of that. Jim and I lived in Saudi Arabia for 12 years. He took a job there in January of
1987.
September of 87, and he announced to us that he would be moving our two children, which were then 3 years old and 5 years old, and myself to Saudi Arabia, and I promptly asked him, with what wife were you planning to go, because I'm not going to go.
She went kicking and screaming.
It was
literally clawing the asphalt until we got on the plane. And then she couldn't get the door open to get back out once we were taken off.
So he did manage to get her there.
Yeah.
But at any rate, we have so much to be able to share. I'm going to try to just tell you very quickly how we wound up looking for this wonderful mountain on the other side of Saudi Arabia. And that would be a mountain called Jebel al-Lawz. And Jebel Makla in Arabic, and we were I wanted to say happily working and over there in Saudi Arabia, but I wasn't really happy about being there at the beginning, to be sure. But after the Gulf War, the children and I were actually sent out, as were most of the families, during the time of the Gulf War. We lived right on the Persian Gulf. The Scud missiles were actually flying over our home to get to Dahran, Saudi Arabia, and from, you know, the first Gulf War. So it was very dangerous for the women and children to be there. To make a long story short, I didn't return to Saudi Arabia until July of 1991. And it was a whole new world after the Gulf War had taken place. And it was very difficult for us in a lot of different ways to readjust to living there. But Jim was working a night shift out at, this is at the time was the largest.
Why was it hard to readjust?
Well, everything had changed a great deal after the Gulf War. 600,000 U.S. soldiers were on Saudi Arabian territory, and there was a great controversy about that because Saudi Arabia is considered the holiest Islamic country of all because they contain the cities and the shrines at Mecca and Medina, which are the holiest of all to the Muslims. And the idea that that many Christians or other religions,
pagans,
what they would consider to be infidels, were on their soil, the whole dynamic of the region changed very dramatically in how they perceived us being there. So as we're trying to readjust, and we were almost apart for a year because of what had happened there, and for us to fly back into that and try to get readjusted to the life we had there, which is a very different life living on an American compound, it was very difficult. In fact, we were at each other's throats quite a bit, and it's a miracle that we are still sitting here together with you, I would add. But God had a plan that was so fantastic and so amazingly we could have never dreamed of something as big as what we wound up being dropped right down into the middle of. Uh-huh. Jim worked a night shift out at the refinery, which was the largest in the world at that time, right there on near the Straits of Hormuz in the Persian Gulf on the east side of Arabia. And he went into work one evening, and I went to pick him up at 11 p.m. because he was working a 3 to 11 shift. And when I saw him walking out toward me, toward the vehicle, this is the early part of December of 1991, it was as though his hair was blown back. He was white as a ghost, and I thought, oh my gosh, something awful has happened. But when he got in the truck, he could barely even speak to me. And by the time we got back to our house, which was only a 5-minute drive, I mean, you know, you're right there on the compound, he began to tell me in very broken language just what he had seen. And he had had an enormous vision. Wow. And this was a man who wasn't so sure that visions existed.
Uh-huh. I was very skeptical of visions, of people that had visions and then tried to... It may be a vision concerning your life or one thing or another about your, you know, what you're doing. And so visions were, you know, distant to me. I had never had a vision. I went into work at evening, to make a long story, very well detailed in her book, by the way, this whole story. But I had a vision that the Ark of the Covenant was being carried through the desert back to the place that it was built, and that I was to go there, and that we were going to find the Ark in a cave. And then the vision stopped. So when she met me, I'm pouring over this in my mind. To be honest with you, I didn't even know where the Ark of the Covenant was built. That was my lack of knowledge of the Old Testament. And I'm telling her this vision and the other things that went along with it, and I'm saying, we've got to go to Mount Sinai. We've just got to go. And she's just saying, what are you talking about? I don't understand. What are you talking about? I said, no, this is so real. It's giving me chills down. It was so real to me that we have to go there. And so for the next 3 weeks, this was in December the 4th, as a matter of fact, of 1991. For the next 3 weeks, we planned on going, driving our vehicle across Saudi Arabia, 24-hour drive, entering into Jordan, crossing the ferry onto the Sinai Peninsula and going to to Mount Sinai, which is where we thought it was, of mm-hmm. course. And, of course, in the Bible, it talks about the Ark of the Covenant and its construction. And of course, it is at the base of Mount Sinai. So this is what propelled us to go to make this driving trip across Arabia by ourselves. I broke all of the cardinal rules of traveling in the desert alone. Mm-hmm. And I just didn't care. I said, we are going. This is so powerful in me. The drive was so strong that we could not go. Mm-hmm. So this is what we did.
You know, and initially, we did not have a clue that there was a controversy over the location of the real Mount Sinai. I mean, after all, you know, in fact, I'd known people who had gone and made a pilgrimage to the traditional site in the Sinai Peninsula of Egypt, St. Catherine's, Jebel Musa. And so we just plotted our course to go exactly straight there. Mm-hmm. But in that little interim time, that 3-week period of time, I'll just have to explain this to you. Over there in Arabia, customs dictates everything. When you go in, even if you are a Christian or any other religion other than being a Muslim, they don't allow you to have any kind of jewelry or a Bible or anything like that. Now, there's plenty of them there because people smuggle them in all the time. But it's very, very difficult to maintain any kind of practice of what you believe unless you do it behind closed mm-hmm. doors. Mm-hmm. So
everything's underground,
right,
as far as the church goes.
We managed to get hold of a VHS copy of the movie, The Ten Commandments, that somebody had smuggled in. You know, uh-huh. Charlton Heston, uh-huh. the whole thing. And so for 3 weeks, my children are now 7 years old and 9 years old. For 3 weeks, we solidly watched that movie day in and day out. Now, I know that it's not exactly mm-hmm. what the scripture mm-hmm. says, but, you know, for a 7-year-old and a 9-year-old, we wanted them to have some kind of concept of why this is so important mm-hmm. and why are we blasting mm-hmm. off to drive to Egypt mm-hmm. to go to this place. And you know, we taught them about the Ark of the Covenant and everything, but Jim was devouring Exodus. And so was I.
I had actually tore the Exodus out of my Bible. I had an amplified and then taped it up so I could fold it up and put it in my pocket and get into the refinery in the evening. Because if you were caught with something like that, you're out of the kingdom. That's it. So we would be, you know, I would get into work, and I worked in the evening shift alone. And so when, as soon as I made my round, I would be sitting there, and then I would pour through and just reread and read and see what the geography of this place was going to be like, get a mental impression of what we were to see when we would go. Because I really didn't know what the traditional site looked like, but what we should see through the eyes of the people that were there. And then, like she said, in conjunction with getting home and with the children, watching the this movie, the Cecil B. DeMille, The Ten Commandments, I mean, it built an image in our hearts and minds that we were going to find when we got to the traditional location.
And lo and behold, as we started making this driving journey across Arabia, it was just us and our kids in the truck by ourselves. And we took off from Ras Sanura, I mean, right on... We lived a block from the water of the Gulf, of the Persian Gulf. We took off from there. It's about 27 or so hours up to a town called Hakal, which is the border of Jordan. You cross on over into Aqaba, Jordan. At that time, the Israeli borders were not open. We could only get into Egypt on the Sinai by taking what they called the Arab Bridge, or this huge big ferry, the kind that holds 1,000 people and you can drive semi-trucks and cars and trailers onto. So that's what we did. And that's how we wound up on the Egyptian Sinai, headed for Mount Sinai. But what started happening to us as we went along was nothing short of, I don't know any other way to tell you, but supernatural events began to happen to us. One of the most profound, and you'll see in a little while, we have some film and we have some photographs to show you and your viewing audience that are very startling. And one of those things was it actually began to snow on us in a place in Saudi Arabia. Now, granted, it was January, but we were not up in the high mountains. And this event, that's right.
Never snows in mid-Arabia.
Once every 75 years or so, that you might see a snowfall there. And it began to snow on us. And we videoed it. Jim was videoing it to prove to people this is not sleet or hail. This is actually snow. What we didn't realize until he was zooming in with the camera is these little snowflakes that were falling were all looked exactly alike.
Unusual.
That's not really supposed to happen. No. I mean, we learn very young in science that all snowflakes are different. But then it dawned on us, oh my gosh, what are we looking at? Because every single one of them, it was like, if you're a mom, you'll know what I'm talking about. You roll out cookie dough, and you take a little heart-shaped cutter, and you cut out a bunch of little hearts. Well, these just happened to be a bunch of little six-pointed stars of David. They were all identical. And you know, no, but you don't have to believe me, but I've got film to prove it. And I hope we'll be able to get into that and show it later.
We don't have it with us, unfortunately.
Oh, you don't?
You have to go to our website.
Okay. Actually, it is.
It
is a live video. You can check on our website.
You can hear the kids screaming in the background and see the video of it. Not the freeze frame on the snowflakes.
But things like that began to happen to us as we were headed toward Egypt. And we were noting them as, wonder what in the world is going on here. But this continued throughout our whole trip. To make a very long story short. In fact, I'll just tell you, the book, I call the book The God of the Mountain, because there's been a lot of talk about this as a potential, this Jebel Law's being the real mountain. But the story that hasn't been told is the fact that it's not really, it is about archaeology to us, because that's your initial doorway into understanding that something might have been historically wrong for a number of years. But it's really more to us personally about the leading of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who carried us into Egypt and out again, which is such a parallel to what he did to the children of Israel. into Egypt and out again. And we began to see these parallels as we went. So what I wrote in the book was every little detail that happened to us. And there were so many of those little supernatural events that, you know, I've got almost a 500-page book, and it's only the first three trips we made to the region. So at any rate, we ended up making 15. But what ended up happening, we got to this traditional site. And because it was so fresh in our minds, what the book of Exodus records ought to be there, or at least the lay of the land that ought to be able to contain the tents of a million plus people, something was grossly disappointing as we pulled up through the Wadi systems and pulled up to the traditional site. It was, the first thing I remember being astounded by is, that mountain doesn't look high at all. How could they lose Moses up there? If he's at the top of that mountain, everybody in the valley could see him. I could see the top of the mountain. And so we became very disappointed. Jim and I looked at each other and went,
something's wrong.
Maybe that was not a real vision. Maybe we're just all wet and we built this all up in our minds and, you know, we're
a wild goose chase.
It's a wild goose chase, and we just really wanted a big adventure, so maybe we made it all up. Maybe it wasn't as much as you thought. Well, for about the next 3 weeks, we had that much time off, and we actually did the whole rest of Egypt. We drove our truck from Cairo all the way down to the border of Sudan.
Wow.
And back up again. But one of the things that happened to us when we were in the very beginning entering into the Sinai Peninsula, they compounded our truck and threw it in customs for 2 days, and they would not release our truck. We didn't have the proper paperwork to get our vehicle into Egypt. So immediately they...
You know, you had gone through Egypt to get there.
Yes.
Well, it was the initial...
It was the initial
trip going across the ferry. When we got to customs, our vehicle was taken and impounded.
Yeah, it was impounded.
Okay.
So we were not planning to exit the country by the same way we had come in. We were actually going to drive up to Alexandria and go across into Israel from that way, because you could get in from Egypt to Israel at that time. You could not get in from Jordan to Israel except by way of Egypt. Because that was back in 1991, 1992, and they had not yet opened up the Allenby Bridge and the various other entrances from Jordan. So we were forced, by virtue of that little detail, which we now know was a complete arrangement from on high, to leave the country by the same way we came in. And so we were on our way back up, back onto the Sinai after having driven all the way down to Sudan. We were at the tip of the Sinai Peninsula in a place called Sharm el-Sheikh. And we were at a hotel there just waiting our time. Because of the nature of the Saudi Arabian laws, we had to stay out of the country a certain amount of days before he, as an employee, was allowed back in the country. So we had about a week left. And we were just sitting at the tip of the Sinai. There's a beautiful underwater reef there called Ras Mohammed, and we're avid divers, and you know, we were just, okay, we've given up the spiritual journey of this because we must have just been all wet about this Sinai and the Ark and all of this. So we were trying not to be too disappointed and just enjoying what had to offer. The hotel had a little gift shop, and it was very, it wasn't a bookstore. There was one little bookshelf, and in that bookshelf, I saw something caught my eye, the Gold Mines of Midian. Now, this was a reprint of a book that was written by Sir Richard Burton in the 1800s, and he was an explorer of vast portions of what is now Saudi Arabia, but it was the Ottoman Empire at the time. Make a long story short, in the back of this book written in the 1800s, he had hand-penned a map of northwest Saudi Arabia, and he had the land of Midian on the east side of the Gulf of Aqaba, squarely in northwest Saudi Arabia. And when Jim and I looked at that, we went, oh my goodness, if Midian in the 1800s was known not to be in the Sinai, but to in fact be in northwest Saudi Arabia, we're looking in the wrong place for the mountain. Mountain's got to be in Midian.
That was a relief as well as a disappointment,
I guess.
No, it was overwhelming excitement. I mean, we all of a sudden re-energized the possibility that we may still be on to something, that this could be real. And the very next day, we went back in there, a book that wasn't there the previous day, appeared, and it was a great big volume. We couldn't have missed it, but it was called the Mountain of God, and it was by Emmanuel Anati, an archaeologist that was working in the southern Negev on a place called Har Karkum. And in the very first few sections of the book, he points out that the traditional location is in question, big question mark there, and that one of the possibilities was in Arabia, called Jebel Outlaws. That was a clue. And then he had, a couple pages later, an identikit for what you should find if you found the right mountain. And the traditional site fits none of the criteria.
That's right.
And he didn't say anything about Jebel Laws, but we knew through her connection, the land of Midian. Moses was in Midian. He had the encounter with the burning bush in Midian. Mm-hmm. Let's go. So for the next few days, we poured through these two books and then formulated our trip back into Arabia. We would cross back over the ferry, and then we would get down into this region and look for the highest mountain that we could find, mm-hmm, and see what might be there.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. And it was, I remember just being wild about, oh, can we leave today? Can we leave today? We've got to get back into Saudi Arabia. We've just got to be able to get back into Saudi Arabia. So that's really... the details of that journey and what happened to us day by day is what the book is about. Mm-hmm. But what we saw when we got there was absolutely mind-boggling. And you know, that term just doesn't fit truly. Mm-hmm. I don't know how to describe this to you. When we first stood at the base of this mountain, that's called Jebel Laws, or specifically Jebel Maqlan. Again, we'll show you the differences here in the next few minutes. All I can remember is, you know, I have a big, sturdy fellow right here. Mm-hmm. And we stood at the base of that mountain, and his knees buckled out from under him. The next thing I knew, he was on the ground. And as soon as I saw him on the ground, my knees gave out from under me, and I was on the ground. And it was as though... So everything that was on the inside of us said, you're home. Mm. You're here.
Yeah.
You have found it. Not because of previous lifetimes or reincarnation or anything
something in your
goofy
spirit,
like that. But something, there was
connected.
A witness there. Call it a residual glory. I don't know. I don't know how to explain it. But we knew that we knew that we knew.
But the presence of the Holy Spirit was so strong, you couldn't stay on your feet.
Yes. And the very next thing that enveloped us and just shook us to the core was, bring this to my people, Israel.
Wow.
Say it again.
Bring this to my people, Israel. Israel.
Wow. Mm.
And think of it. If this is the real Mount Sinai, whom would it be the most important?
To Israel.
It's not, well, the other one down south that they think is it, some of them, that's important to them. Even though they have all the discrepancies, and I've talked to rabbis about it, and they said, oh, you're all wet. It's not down there. But you're exactly right.
It's really amazing, after being there the first time, we had these moments for about the scope of 45 minutes to an hour, and then the frontier forces, police forces, were on us. Now, these are a police force that live in the desert. They are of the government of Saudi Arabia, but they are not like dispatched from a headquarters or something. They keep their headquarters in the desert. And it wasn't very long before they knew that there were faces there that were not local.
Mm-hmm.
And
was there other people there?
We had only
the
seen
local
the local nomadic peoples, the Bedouin. They live all in the region, depending on what time of the year is. They're either closer up in the mountains or they're closer to the sea.
Mm-hmm.
And those people have always been, you know, very friendly to us. We had traveled extensively throughout Arabia before we ever made this wonderful trip to Egypt that started all of this. But they'd always been very friendly to us and everything. Mm-hmm. And to have these forces roar up and pull out AK-47s,
uh-oh,
and say, get out, in no uncertain terms.
Were you behind a fence or anything?
Well,
No, not at the moment
not
that they
the
pulled
time
up.
They came
we
up.
We had been escorted into the area by a Bedouin's young boy, a 10-year-old, had opened the gate, taken us into the guard shack, which was vacated at the time, brought us around to where the pillars were, where the what we call this covenant site, and that's where both of us fell to our knees. And that was that experience. But after a while, he had gone ahead, he came back to us, and then we walked back around. It's a pretty good walk, takes about 15 minutes, back around to our truck. By the time we walked up to the truck, here comes the Frontier Forces.
Yeah.
And they jump out, and I cannot express how they tried to instill fear in us and intimidate us and insist that we leave. And I'm surprised that something worse didn't happen, but it didn't, and we were able to leave. But just the point is that was our very first experience at this mountain. We've been back 15 times.
Wow. In fact,
that's
3 weeks later.
That's how important it is.
The other thing that overwhelmed us after we got that kind of a reaction was, who do they think they are?
Yes.
And why are you not allowed?
Yes.
I think what welled up inside of us was like, wait a minute. Not only do we have a perfect right to be here, this belongs to our people.
Uh-huh.
And livid. We were livid. It was like,
yes,
how
livid.
Dare you tell us we cannot be here?
Uh-huh.
But of course, you know, at the other end of the weapon,
yeah,
you're not going to argue too
right.
much. We kept this internalized.
Can I rewind the tape? What you mentioned pillars. You lost me there.
Right. Moses erected 12 pillars, each one of them representing one of the tribes of Israel.
At that place?
At this place.
And
exactly.
They're still standing?
And they're still there. That's what we're
well,
going to show
nine
you.
Of them.
Nine of them are still
yeah.
there. But and the ground has been through earthquakes and other things, and it's kind of scattered around. But you can still see with not much imagination. That this was set up, there was a platform built, pillars were erected. It's an amazing site, yes.
And
still there, 3,500. That's why I think that this site and this
for
place.
For the tabernacle?
The foundation
yes.
of the tabernacle, we believe we have located where it
yes.
was sitting. You know, it's the most significant biblical find in the modern era.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody knows about it. And what we're here about is
and
we're
not
we're
a biblical scholar and TV evangelist or anything, just plain.
Jim and Penn.
Yeah.
Just plain Penn.
But we're going to run out of time, and
okay,
I have
so
a lot of exciting things I'd like to share
yeah.
with you.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd like to roll what I call, there are 2-minute segments. There's a lot of information. People describe it, and I heard someone else say that, you know, it's like being hit with a fire hose of information. There will
sure.
be a lot of information. Of course, we're not going to be able to get to all of it. But I would like to show the first roll-in, which is Sinai and Horeb, and it's going to give you an overview of the whole place.
All right. That's ready to roll. Let's see it.
Horeb in northwest Saudi Arabia, we found ourselves gazing in awe toward the south at the majestic beauty of Mount Sinai. Blackened and different from all its surrounding companions, this mountain stands apart at first glance. As we began our climb up the northern flank of this unique mountain, the divide line between light and dark granite became glaringly obvious. Exodus 24:17 records that the sight of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on top of this mountain. And now, sitting on Sinai's very peak, the color of these rocks can truly be seen. Coming into view now is the granite peak called the Brown Laws by ancient maps. After extensive research, we believe that Horeb and Sinai are two distinct mountains, and that is why they're referred to that way in Scripture. But for now, we'll go back to our view from the top of Sinai, and as you can see here, the valley floor below is enormous and well able to contain the huge numbers comprising those who came out of Egypt. About halfway up the eastern face of Sinai is this hidden valley that can't be seen from below. Exodus 24:9 and 10 tells us of a meeting of the Lord with Moses, Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and 70 elders of Israel. They saw God at a distance and as it were a pavement of sapphire under his feet. And glancing upward to where the glassy blackness appears, it's not difficult to imagine a deep blue shine here from the glory of the Lord. Looking all the way down into the camp, we get our first glimpse of the altar to the golden calf. Fenced and forbidden by the Saudis to enter, we would have to devise a plan to get close-up footage of this on another trip. In the same manner, close in to the base of Sinai, we saw the clear image of a double wall corral leading up to a slaughter area and an altar of earth and uncut stone. Just behind the altar is a dry stream bed running from the mountain all the way into the valley below. Moses cast the remnants of the golden calf into the brook that came out of the mount, according to Deuteronomy 9:21. Here you can see the fence that the Saudis have erected to keep people out of this area. It is extensive and encloses a guard outpost visible here. They are quite serious about keeping the eyes of the world off this mountain.
Wow.
That is a lot of information.
And that's 3 minutes of six of the roll-ins that we've brought.
Uh-huh.
But it is a tremendous amount of information. And to watch that just, you know, it brings it back so vividly in my mind. It gives me chills to see just how this is preserved. And we're going to get in further into each one of the areas that we talked about, the golden calf altar, a place where Moses built the altar where he sacrificed oxen, the pillars that he erected, each one representing one of the 12. So we're going to see that as well.
It became very apparent to us that they had no intention of allowing this information to leave that country.
Sure.
So it became very clear to us that our mandate then must be getting a film record of what is there. Film and still photography and anything we could, just in case they ever decided to eradicate it. Mm-hmm. I would hope and pray that they would never do such a thing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, in the geopolitical climate we live in right now, where all the earth seems to want to wipe Israel off mm-hmm. the map, I'm not well convinced that they would not try to rid themselves of any sort of
right.
Israeli history.
Mm-hmm. Well, they did it on the Temple Mount. Why not?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
And now they claim the temple didn't even exist.
Mm-hmm.
So
let's bring up photos 2 through 10. And we'll kind of just step through these, maybe a couple seconds each.
Okay.
And that is our original slide. There we go.
Well, There we go. This is the mountain that we do believe is the real Mount Sinai. We're looking from the north to the south. It's actually called Jebel Makla. And you can see it's a very different color from all the surrounding mountains.
Mm-hmm.
There's argument as to whether or not it's charred black or whether that's just natural basalt, but to us there's so many other reasons why this mountain is the real Mount Sinai. It's almost a moot point to us. But if you go ahead and bring up the next one, this we believe is Mount Horeb. This is properly called Jebel Laws. It's about from peak to peak, what, about 5 miles?
About 5 miles, of course.
The area is enormous. This Jebel Laws, we believe sincerely, is Mount Horeb for a lot of different reasons, but one of which is there is something in the Bible calls the Rock of Horeb. You never hear it spoken of as the Rock at Sinai. And if you make Sinai and Horeb the same mountain, then you've got a problem with where you locate the rock that Moses struck that the waters came from, which we'll be able to show you, we believe, pretty clearly here just shortly.
Next slide.
But these two mountains, it's interesting. That is Jim right there that you see. September 24th of 1992, we finally made it to the top of what we believe to be Sinai. And you can see the distance now where the arrow's pointing. We believe that is Horeb, and that split
no
rock is on
the problem with the guards
the
going up
side.
There?
Oh, yeah, there were problems. We managed to figure out other ways to get up there.
Okay.
Well, we didn't go from the front. We would drive around to the back. Jump out of the truck with backpacks on, hide the truck, and run as fast as we could to get away from the truck and disappear up into the mountains.
Mm-hmm. And we would spend 5 days camping in the mountains, so we would be away from the vehicle quickly, and that would give us a chance to get up and to hide ourselves. And it just happens to be on that, you saw September 24th, 1992. Mm-hmm. That was my 38th birthday, so I was blessed by God to be able to spend my birthday waking up on the top of Mount Sinai, which was an incredible experience. Go ahead and bring up the next slide. This is actually from the top of that mountain that you saw across the valley, which we call Horeb. We managed to climb to the top of it. If you notice the date, and this was happens chance, these are the type of God things that happened to us. That is September 24th of 94. That happened to be my 40th birthday. So we were able to spend my 40th birthday on top of the other peak, which is what we call Mount Horeb.
And you can see real clearly right there how very different that the black whole, that whole mountain is very different from all the surrounding mountains. And, you know, like I said, whether it's charred black or whether it's natural rock, it's irrelevant almost to me, because the fact that God would choose a different place to come down on. And this mountain absolutely stands apart from any of the others in the region.
Next slide. And this was the 1992 trip when we made it to the top. To the left of the screen in the center, you can't see it that well, but that is the Gulf of Aqaba. So your vantage point and your view from that location is, and it's one of the reasons why I was trying to get to the top, because we could not figure out the lay of the land. It was so convoluted and so huge that to get a perspective of where we were and where all these things fit together, that's one of the reasons why we made it to the top. The next slide.
This is something, particularly for any of your viewers who may have seen pictures of this mountain, or because I'm telling you, it's all over the web.
It is.
There's many, many, many websites and various films and stuff that's been made thus far about this. But there's a confusion. When you're standing in the valley below and you're looking up, we've got it circled in red. Everyone thinks that in that circle is the top of the mountain. And in reality, it's nowhere near the top of the mountain.
Really?
These areas are so large. Yeah, go ahead. If that same circle, we are now up on the top looking down. And that circle that you see is the same black peak you just saw from the other side.
Really?
So it's really the first peak that you see from the valley. But the valley, the angles are so steep, you cannot see the real peak from the valley. So we really wanted to open this up to everyone to show them that little thing where it says campsite. There's a tiny little blue dot in the middle of that little circle, and that's our tent. So we still kept climbing. That black peak you see, that the first peak you see from the valley floor is on the left. That little blue tent is where that middle arrow is, and the real top of the mountain is right up there.
Oh, my God.
So, a mile and a half from the valley. It's enormous. And again, Moses could have been up there for 40 days and been missing because there's no way that you would see him, you know, at the top of the mountain.
Yep.
And then the next slide. And then this gives you a perspective of what we're talking about, the location. You see Mount Horeb to the north of, and Mount Sinai to the south of. And just to put them on a geographical map and their relationship to each other, a little skewed north and south.
Mount Horeb looks like granite.
Yes, it is.
It's a
Mount Sinai doesn't look like the same.
It's actually a bluish stone that is a basalt. Some of the geologists called it original earth. That's what they call it. That was their name for it. And it has a blackened patina, which is desert varnish, they call it, on it. But from the crater area, we talked about it in the roll-in, and if you're in that place where we believe the 70 elders went, where they could see God at a distance, that stone has cast a blue hue that is very, very much like the sky. And it talks about the sapphire pavement under the feet of God as being blue or sapphire, as if it were as clear as the heavens. And you can see that it blends right into the blueness of the sky. Just another little thing about this place that is so incredibly significant. Do we want to?
Yeah, let's go ahead. If you'll pull the next one up, this was brought to our attention by Dr. Glenn Fritz. He's a very dear friend. He is a geographer, PhD. He has a magnificent work he has just released called The Lost Sea of the Exodus, and it's a geographical analysis. And, of course, he did most of his research on where the crossing site would have been. But he brought this to our attention a number of years ago,
And this is really profound, the insight he had about this particular thing.
We were listening to a teaching on this last night, but this is from his, as a geographer, he went back to the Greek and he studied this and he called us up one day and he was really excited. He said, guys, you will not believe what this says. And I said, what are you talking about? He said, Galatians 4:25. And 26, he says, where it says this Mount Sinai is in Arabia, that's pretty self-evident, right? I mean, that's Paul speaking. Yeah, it's in Arabia.
God knew the difference between Arabia and Egypt.
Yeah, a lot of difference, you would think. And then it says, and answereth to Jerusalem. He said that term is used once in the Bible, and it's a geography. It's a term that's used only in geography, where you're describing to march in a straight line. And he said the other term that's a once use in the Bible is above. And he said that means to the north of. So literally you could say that Jerusalem is north of Mount Sinai in a straight line due south.
Uh-huh.
So the next slide brings us to that line coming down from Jerusalem due south on the same line of longitude passes right between this Mount Horeb and Mount Sinai.
Isn't that amazing?
Oh, that is amazing.
Isn't that, I mean, we saw that and just danced about for quite a while.
How
because
literal the scripture is.
Exactly.
In its description.
Yeah, exactly.
Uh-huh. So again, you have to be at the right location to be able to determine these things. If you were looking for that that connection at the traditional site, it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Because
right.
It's to the southwest mm-hmm. of Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't make any sense. So again, you know, as we see these things unfold, it's amazing. Do we want to go to the altar?
Yeah, pillars? let's go ahead. We're doing well
this
here.
This will be the.
Oh, you're talking about the video?
Yeah. Well, just a quick on the photo that's up. We're seeing Mount Horeb and Mount Sinai, and then there's another box to the right at the bottom. It says Altar Corral Pillars in Elijah's Cave, just to let you know that it's located on the east side of Mount Sinai and where it is in relationship to the rest of it. So go ahead and roll in altar pillars.
Next to it is a slaughter platform and the altar. The stream bed can be seen running behind and around the corral, as well as the white pillars out in front. From well inside the forbidden fence, I soon discovered the Saudis had completed a partial excavation of this site in 1996. You can plainly see the outlines of the slaughter platform and the corral directly behind it. Next to that is a pit, complete with layer upon layer of ash, and the access area to the sacrificial altar. In Exodus 24:5, young men sacrificed many oxen as peace offerings to the Lord there at Sinai. This large corral would have been necessary to lead them up to the slaughter platform. There they would have been sacrificed and the blood captured in basins, and Moses would have placed the offerings into the fire directly behind him. The altar itself was just beyond the fire, and there he sprinkled the blood. Just in front of the corral and the altars are the remains of white pillars and their foundation stones. We have found them to be made of a crude and discovered the source of this stone near the crossing site of the Red Sea. Moses built an altar and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel as recorded in Exodus 24:4. These pillars are each of differing sizes, possibly according to the number of each tribe of Israel that they represented. As you can see, they are very, very well preserved. Looking back upward from the altar area, a large cave is visible from below. 1 Kings 19:8-9 tell us that Elijah came to Horeb, mountain of God, and then found a cave to lodge in. This is yet another bit of evidence needed to identify Mount Sinai, found here at Jebel Laws. I was only able to get inside this cave once, but it was well worth this spectacular view of the valley below.
You can tell, even just by looking out of that cave, how vast That area is out in front of that mountain. You could have put 10 million people in that valley out there. There's well enough room to have been able to
the encampment.
Put the people there that the scripture says came up out of Egypt when the mixed multitude and everything. There's plenty enough room there for it. But this is astonishing to us that these pillars are there, that this formation is there. One of the things that was amazing to us, in the beginning, it's been said that perhaps these white marble pillars were a shrine that Solomon built at some time later to commemorate that this was where the real Mount Sinai was. Well, Jim and I never were of that opinion, and the more that Jim was able to get down into that area behind the fence, he's been back there quite a few times, and the more he was able to get down in there, a picture began to develop in his mind based upon a childhood experience he had had.
What she's talking about is when I was in my teens, I would go to the farm, and it was always this thing with my grandfather that we were going to work. The kids don't want to work, but he's going to work you. You come there, you're going to work, and then you eat. That's always the thing. So, but we would work on the bullpen. And he had, this is, 40, 50 years ago, and the bullpens were made out of wood, and there was always repairs to be made. But the thing that was significant is when we would run the bulls or the animal, the cattle, up into this thing, they would come up to what's called the squeeze. There was always an angle of where this narrow corridor took them to before they went up to the squeeze, where they do the branding and these other things. And animals typically will bolt, especially if they're cutting and this kind of thing, when they sense this. So that's why that angle is there. And when I was standing in this area and looking out back at this L-shaped, what people previously called the altar, I called it the corral because it so fit the idea of a bullpen and a mechanism for them to be able to handle oxen and bring them up to an altar for sacrifice.
Right.
So that was part of the thinking. Now, if you bring up slide number 24.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, he's got, this is a view from up above looking down at the corral. Go ahead and go through the next couple of slides. And the animal shoots. Okay, and then there you go. You see the double-walled corral where they would have been bringing them up. Again, this is the sacrificial area.
And it looked exactly like the bullpen from, his childhood.
Yeah.
So why would this be in the middle of the desert floor, in the middle of absolutely nowhere, at the base of this mountain that already has some of these other characteristics that we're starting to see fit the biblical description exactly? There's a stream, as you saw in the roll-in, there's a stream bed that comes out of this thing. There's these pillars and foundation blocks, which we can go ahead to. We've got the next several slides.
Let's go to the next slide. That's again, we're talking about the animal chutes. And then the next slide, just pointing out different elements of this whole thing, the slaughter platform. Next slide. Again, we see the altar, which would have been an earthen altar. And then again, the next one, which would be the ash pit. If you're looking, I always say, if you're looking for the ashes of the original sacrifice or the ashes of the red heifer, this would be the place. Wish I'd have brought a sample. Didn't think about that part of it. So, go ahead and talk about this one.
Okay. On the east side, we found this very large rock, and when I say very large, it's probably 20 feet across, maybe 20 feet high, very large rock. And we found this interesting bunch of ancient graffiti on it here. We've been told by various archaeologists that have actually looked at this picture that all of these images were not etched onto this rock at the same time. This is progressive years of etching, if you will. But what stood out to us is that these either oxen or bovine creatures, some of them are facing this way to the left, and then there's others that are facing over to the right. And on a few of them, you see a man or a stick figure type behind them. And we were actually told by someone who actually has large animals that you don't pull oxen are large cattle. The only way to get them to move is to get behind them and prod them.
Mm-hmm.
And so we wonder, right,
mm-hmm.
exactly. So we wonder, now granted, we are certainly not archaeologists, neither would I ever propose to say that we are. But this is very interesting to us to have been found right in this vicinity where this V or L-shaped stone formation is in the middle of the desert. And there's this etching of cattle going this way and then cattle going back this way. And we wonder, you know, is this a picture of what was going on there?
Mm-hmm.
You know, only someone who knows could tell, but...
And this is my recreation, a little little crazy with Photoshop, but what I'm showing here is someone behind the cow or the oxen, pushing them ahead up to the slaughter platform. You see where Moses would have been, and then you see an arrangement of the 12 pillars out in the middle. I don't know how well that's going to be able to be seen, but it's just an artist's rendition of what may have been there.
And the funny thing about it is we have traveled extensively in the Middle East. I've been all over the places in Jordan, all the ruins up to the edge of Syria, Israel. I've never seen a mechanism that looks like this
mm-hmm.
anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a dwelling place of someone. It's a very unique and odd, odd formation.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead and roll the next four photos. And here we're talking about these pillars that are
uh-huh.
out in the front.
Uh-huh.
The next slide. And we see that there are six that I counted in this photo. And then to the next slide is seven and eight. And then I think there's one more. That in situ, this would have been like I found it in 1992. Now, there has been an excavation in there. Some of these photos are from that era in 2003. Some of them have been moved since the original layout. But you can see that there are pillars on the ground. And then the next slide, this is the foundation stones. And they're a cubit by two cubit, you know, about 18, 20 inches by 40 inches, 42 inches. And they would have laid a platform in there for them to set these pillars on. A lot of work,
wow,
a lot
yes.
of effort and energy went in, not mm-hmm. standing up some stones, but memorial to what God was doing with them at this site. And then the next slide is where I take this, and each one of the pillars being a different height, and just using the number of each tribe, smallest pillar being 12 inches, and then extrapolating what the tallest pillar would be, and that would be the tribe of Judah, and it comes out to about 36 inches. And each one of these pillars fits into this linear graph almost perfectly, except there are three missing.
Wow. Yeah, the scripture's pretty plain. It says when Jacob set up a pillar for Rachel's grave, it says Jacob set up a pillar.
Mm-hmm.
What the scripture says about Moses is Moses built an altar and 12 pillars.
Mm-hmm.
If it meant he stood a stone up, it would have said he stood a stone up as a pillar.
Yeah.
It's very clear what it says with Jacob.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not what it says. It says he builded an altar and 12 pillars.
Wow.
This was a betrothal and a ceremony at the base of Mount Sinai that wed Israel to the Lord God Almighty.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What was supposed to be for all time.
Yes.
And very quickly that disintegrated into the golden calf incident,
mm-hmm.
which we have a very good candidate for shortly. But
all right, next photo, which would be 31. And this, when we went back in 2003, we were able to make a climb up to the quarry where these marble pillars were taken from. And there are a couple that were marred that were not brought down the mountain, down into the valley.
Mm.
And this is an example of one of those. And then you can go ahead to the next slide.
I found this to be just stunning. And this is the reason. You can see that there's a little bit of a white area up there that those two black arrows are pointing at. And this, to me, when I was looking at this picture and reading in the scripture, this specific scripture, look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the hole in the quarry from which you were dug. The previous scripture to that is, look unto your mother Sarah and your father Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
This is the Lord God speaking out to Israel, saying, look where you've come from.
Mm-hmm.
It's very clear to whom he's speaking.
Mm-hmm.
And here at this mountain, there is a quarry in the side of the mountain from which 12 marble pillars were pulled. one pillar for each of the tribes of Israel mm-hmm. that were brought down to the base of that mountain and the blood sprinkled on them. Mm. How much more perfect a picture can you have of what the Lord our God, how he feels about his law and how he feels about his people? Pulled from his very side,
yes.
the mountain of God. You know, I mean, and to find this there on the ground and in the side of the mountain, mm-hmm. there's, like I said, there's so much more to this than archaeology. This really, that's only the opening door. Mm-hmm. What is the picture that's painted on the ground there that God wants us to see now, today?
Right, right.
This is what's so amazing to us.
Let's go with the roll-in of the golden calf. I'm going to run out of time.
Across the valley floor from the base of Mount Sinai lie the remarkably preserved remains of the altar to the golden calf. Once again, I was miraculously able to slip inside the fence undetected and record the images of cattle literally covering these rocks. These petroglyphs, or rock carvings, represent distinctly Egyptian gods, with Hathor being the female representation and Apis the male. These gods were actively worshipped in Egypt during the time that the Israelites were held captive there. The story is relayed to us in the 32nd chapter of Exodus, where the people grew restless waiting for Moses to return from the top of Mount Sinai. The people told Aaron, "Up, make us gods to go before us." Aaron took their gold and fashioned for them a molten calf with a graving tool. What is intriguing about the story is that he fashioned a single idol, yet said, in sight of all of Israel, "These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." The scripture makes the same point later in the chapter when Aaron is explaining to what happened to Moses. He claims the people wanted gods to come before them, so he took their gold out, and out came a calf, once again singular. Looking at this site, however, the scripture becomes beautifully clear. Aaron prepared an altar to the idol and then set the calf on the very top. The cattle you see here were carved right into the rocks upon which it sat. Standing back from the spectacle, one would have seen a golden calf sitting atop the rock carvings of Apis and Hathor, their former Egyptian gods. The calf, along with the images beneath it, would have been correctly spoken of as plural. "These be thy gods, O Israel." It is noteworthy to mention that have never been native to Saudi Arabia. These Egyptian gods, carved in stone, found here near the foot of the mountain, surely give us yet another piece of evidence proving the certain truth of the Word of God.
There's quite an abundance of evidence. Not only now do we have the mountain sitting there that's got a cave on it, that's got a brook descending out of it, there's a very unique stone formation. There's pillars and foundation stones, and all of these things are spoken of directly in the scripture. Now, out in the valley where the people would have been, there's a fenced-off area with a bunch of cattle carved on the rock. Wow.
Let's look at 41. Again, we're just talking about these comparisons. Mm-hmm. You can see a photo down in the left
and
showing the style of horns. And then the next slide, which is the apis.
So you can see
the connection to this.
Just
Egyptian.
How similar they are.
And then mm-hmm. the last slide just gives you 43, gives you the grave area.
Wow.
And its location out of the camp, the golden calf altar. And then, all right, that's good.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, we're going to be in for a real thrill, Tommy, when we come back from this short break. And I know you won't want to tune out.
For sure.
And you'll probably be wanting to get a copy of the DVD as well as her book.
And the book.
And the book.
We'll be telling you more about the book when we come back. And, oh, my goodness,
thank
you.
I've got a big question when we come back.
Excellent.
So,
stay tuned. Thank you for sharing this awesome story.
If you enjoyed this program, GLC asks that you would help support us in the production of these programs. You can make your contribution through our website at www.glc.us.com, by phone 432-563-5200 or 1-866-846-5200. Or by mail at P.O. Box 61000, Midland, Texas 79711-1000. We would like to extend our thanks for your prayers and support.
Well, we're glad to be back with you. Now I understand why you were spending so much time with your nose in that book.
That's right. The God of the Mountain, I was on the journey with Jim and Penny, and you can be too. You can take this same adventure. This book is just the beginning of God leading them and how he did it and the many miracles. It's just awesome. It is available in our bookstore and, of course, on their website.
Well, let's get back to them and see what's going on.
Well, I want to tell you, if you are interested in having them come speak and share this, you could probably stay a weekend, right? Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And
absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We love those type of events.
Take that long if you want them. But they are available, and that information is also on the website. So let's pick up where we left off, guys.
Excellent. Well, one of the things I was talking about was this Emmanuel Anati, this archaeologist that had did the work for Israel in the southern Negev. He had this adenokit that I talked about in his book, The Mountain of God. And what we're starting to see is all of those pieces that he, as an archaeologist, said should be there but never found at any site that he has ever looked at or investigated are all starting to fall. Every one of these are falling into place. The next thing that we're going to show you is, and this was one of the elements that has to be there, is a graveyard that could contain 3,000 that died at the Golden Calf
incident.
Right. And
exactly.
There should be a graveyard there. So we're going to go ahead and
Really?
Yes.
I never thought about that.
And Tree, roll in. Let's look at this.
Just east of Mount Horeb and well north of the base of Mount Sinai, a massive graveyard lies undisturbed behind another archaeological fence the Saudis have erected. In this never-before-released footage, you can clearly see the ancient headstones dispersed throughout the area. My dad and I secretly slipped inside this fence to obtain proof on film of this remarkable sight. We know according to Exodus 32:28 that at least 3,000 men died after worshiping the golden calf, and by Levitical law, would have to be buried outside the main camp. Back to the valley, a small white building is surrounded by a rectangular fence. We believe this was built over the ruins of the original tabernacle. Oddly enough, in a high plain between Horeb and Sinai, another rectangular set of stone ruins has been left alone. Moses moved the tabernacle away from the main camp after the golden calf incident. Evidence of this is plainly found here. On their way up into this high pasture, Mom and Dad found another surprise waiting for them. Amazing because of its rarity, an enormous cedar appears out of nowhere, with two others that are actually attached by root systems to this one. As you can see from the sparse landscape with Mount Sinai in the background, there are no others on any of these mountains. Cedars do not grow in this area at all. Why was this one here? Upon closer inspection, the trunk of this cedar is more than 8 feet thick. Smaller olive trees in Israel have been found to be over 2,000 years old. Moses was tending the flocks of Jethro when he turned aside to see the burning bush, and God spoke to him directly. Could this be that very plant? My sister Chelsea and I were also with my parents when we located the almond trees. These are important to find on the mountain because Aaron's rod was made from an almond tree and budded and produced ripe almonds according to Numbers 17:8. The bowls of the golden candlestick were also fashioned after the almond tree. Just as an interesting note, Horeb and Sinai are also covered with fig trees. Though subject to much debate, the nation of Israel has many times been referred to as the fig tree in prophecy. They are to be found only on these two mountains. Finally, quail can be seen all over the area to this day. It is theorized that they fly in huge numbers over the sea from Egypt, only to fall to the ground exhausted on the Arabian side. Exodus 16:13 reads, "And it came to pass at evening, the quails came up and covered the camp."
You can see there's quite a bit of evidence that's gaining momentum here. We started out with that graveyard, and then we went into the other things. And of course, quail are not archaeological remains. Neither are almond trees or fig trees. But obviously, if you know your scripture, these things are highly important. If Aaron had a rod that budded and produced ripe almonds, it was not the rod of an oak tree.
That's right.
It was an almond tree. And the very name Jebel Makla, which is the dark black peak we believe to be Mount Sinai, that very name means almond mountain.
Really?
Jebel Moss.
That's right.
Yeah.
Makla, what I'm talking about is laws. It means almond mountain. Makla, on the other hand, Jebel Makla means the quarry. And what came out of the side of the mountain?
Mm-hmm.
They quarried the pillars out of the side of the mountain. So you have to, you have to forgive me for
I'd never dream there would be laws.
We actually pronounce it laws, but in Hebrew as well as Arabic, there's a lot of those crossover words that are identical, Ras and Rosh. Same meaning, head of, in both Arabic and Hebrew. It's Ras in the Arabic and Rosh in the Hebrew. Laws, they actually pronounce it luz. And it's also pronounced luz in Hebrew, and it means the nut tree, or specifically the almond. So this Jebel Laws, the almond tree, okay? And how specific that is to the golden candlestick. You know, the seven-tier candlestick of the tabernacle was fashioned after the blossoms and the knops, as the King James calls it, of the almond tree. So you have all of these elements coming together right here.
The most important thing that you said, though, when I've had learned rabbis in Israel say to me why Mount Sinai is down in Sinai, I'd say, with all those people that died, where are the bodies?
The graves. The graveyard is the thing that really nails this place down. It is one of the many things about this site.
See, there's none down there.
I'm sorry?
No.
There's none down there.
No, there's none down there. In fact, if we'll
go to photo 43 through 47.
You can see there in the yellow where we've got it marked. Do you see how this map is beginning to fill up around these two mountains of various potential matches to the biblical record?
Okay,
this, what's encompassed in this picture, the outer red ring is a fence that the Saudis have, of course, blocking this area off. But you can see that the landform comes up a bit, and there's like a high platform. This area is larger than the size of a football field. It's enormous. And we do have, as we were speaking of earlier, a biblical precedent that to mark a grave, Jacob took a stone and stood it up as a pillar, which marked the grave of Rachel. So it was something that they did do in this day and time. All of these gravestones are standing out there in this field that the Saudis have marked off. And that's my son. At that point in time, he's far taller than I am now. But at that point in time, he was about my height, which is about 5'2". So you can see the size of these stones.
This is the largest stone in the area, but I'm not exaggerating when I say hundreds to thousands, and not more than that, in this area, with multiple graves and layers of graves. So it's a very, and another interesting point is that they believe, and I believe this this came from Glenn, a friend of ours who had done some lightweight wave imagery of the site. He said all the graves went in at one time. How they know that exactly, I'm not sure, but that was the conclusion that he had come into.
What he said was it appears that all of this ground was disturbed at once. In other words, first off, it's in the middle of nowhere. You don't have enough nomadic population in 1,000 years to produce that amount of graves. But secondarily, the ground appears to have all been disturbed at once. So what we would be talking about is a mass burial in the middle of nowhere. Why? And it's not, the markers there are not in what we have been told, and we lived in Arabia for a long lot of years, they're not burials that are marked in an Islamic fashion. So our best guess is that this happened sometime long before that era, and it all happened at once, and it just happens to be a couple of miles, or kilometers probably, north out of this area where this congregation would have been, if we're correct about the fact that they were there in this valley. So, I mean, you know, you're looking at this, and then you see quail and almond trees and fig trees, and
And the almond trees, again, the almond tree makes a perfect walking stick. And we found that out because I wanted to get a couple from the trees. And the way they come out of the trunk is they come out straight as an arrow for about 6 feet. So you get these nice inch and a half branches that are very straight and long. So we were able to cut a couple of these, and we have brought them back to us. Mm-hmm. But this is Dr. Leonard Moeller, who has written the book, The Exodus Case, which we offer on our website as well. But you can see me standing there with him, and we're showing images, and in our hand, this is a slide from our PowerPoint presentation, so you can't see the hands. But the hands are full of the almonds. And the note on the bottom says that my birthday, September 24th, 54, but notice his.
Same day.
So we have a man on the other side of the planet, and Jim and Penny coming together over this mountain because he had written his book well before he knew who we were, but he was using our images.
Where was he from?
He's from Sweden.
Sweden?
He's from Sweden. And again, he's got a phenomenal work that is called The Exodus Case, and that is offered on our website.
All right.
So I think we ought to go to the rock at Horeb. Roll in.
Possibly the greatest witness giving validity to Mount Sinai being in Arabia is the rock at Horeb. This enormous rock is split cleanly down the middle and is completely different from anything else in the region. It stands high atop one of the boulder hills that dot the landscape and on the west side of Horeb, not Sinai. The Bible identifies it exactly this way. I'm standing on the back side of the rock here, and it's easy to see just how large it really is. As I began my walk between the two giant slabs of rock, I became acutely aware that something entirely miraculous had taken place here long ago. Making my way right through the middle of the split, scriptures started rolling over and over again in my head. They became alive to me as I made it through and sat down on the front side. I began to notice immediately the deep channels that were cut into the stone both in front and the back of this rock. You can see one of these channels clearly here. Deep gouges and grooves are apparent at the base also, along with a strange erosion pattern from below that is unique to this rock and no others in the valley. With rainfall every 10 years amounting to less than an inch here, these very obvious cuts made by copious water flows were indeed compelling. Again, the channels are obvious. As we followed the course of the water all the way down and into the valley, we realized the immediate area under the rock was of a smooth and unbroken granite, unlike the crushed particles of stone we'd been hiking on all over the rest of the region. If this rock was the one Moses struck, the waters would have cooled up substantially and the whole of Israel, including their flocks, could have taken their fill and been satisfied. In addition, a stone altar lies at the ground base of this rock. The Amalek came to fight Israel there at Rephidim, where the rock was, and after the battle, Moses built an altar and called it Jehovah Nissi. This giant stone has a circular pit we believe was formed by cumulative fires. Clean through this rock at the ground level below, evidence of ash can be seen. Psalm 78:15-16 says, "He clave the rocks in the wilderness and gave them drink as out of the great depths. He brought streams also out of the rock and caused the waters to run down like rivers."
Plainly how large that rock really is.
Massive.
And I tell you what, we found that rock the very first time. It was April the 2nd of 1992. We were completely lost. We thought we were going to come up in a valley and climb up over the top of the mountain and get down into that area where the pillars and all are. Mm-hmm. We were completely off base. But you know what? Sometimes you're off base by design.
Yes.
And what ended up happening, we came upon this rock, and if you'll go ahead and put up the map, we'll show you exactly where it's located.
48.
You see in the yellow there, the rock at Horeb. And the reason why I was telling you earlier we believe these two peaks are important is because that rock is never spoken of as the rock at Sinai. It's only ever spoken of as the rock at Horeb. And that is the side, it's on the west side of this other mountain, the one properly called Jebel Lahaz. So that's where it's located, and if you'll go to the next picture, you can see just how it stands out in the landscape.
Uh-huh.
In fact, I put the we made the cover of my book this,
mm-hmm.
because it's very, very specific. You know, in my little Sunday school mind, I guess, I had pictured that Moses tapped a little rock and everybody stood in line with their little cup. No. You got to think way bigger than that. They've been 3 days in the wilderness. That's actually Dr. Leonard Moeller right there in the trip we made in 2003. You can see he's halfway up the rock there.
Uh-huh.
You see how big it is. Everything that we have found in this landscape is far bigger than we could have ever imagined. But what happened is this is an enormous rock, and the miracle that must have taken place there when Moses struck that rock the first time, like Jim has always said, it probably rivals the parting of the Red Sea, because the water that would have gushed forth. But you know what? They were 3 days in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
They had come out of the area of Marah and Elim, and they were 3 days in the desert, no water. A million plus people, flocks, herds,
mm-hmm.
children.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it's one little trickle from like the traditional area, you got people that are going to die before they ever get to the water.
That's right.
But where this thing broke apart, and the waters came up from the great depths, as the scripture says, this would have gone and flowed down into the valley area there, and it would have pooled up, and because of the rocky terrain there, it would have pooled up greatly. We've got a good picture
51,
of that.
Yeah.
You can see out in front of where the rock is, you can see that that whole area in front of it's been washed clean of
mm-hmm.
the topsoil. It's
mm-hmm.
a rock basin. And that water by the gallons would have poured down out of there,
mm.
and it would have pooled up. So the whole nation, you can see how all the rock, it's been
everybody
blasted
could drink
to bedrock right uh-huh. there in front of this rock. Everybody could have drank all at one time.
Uh-huh.
And the very next one, though, this is where it gets profound to us. It's not just a matter of finding a rock that looks good. Scripture says he clave the rocks in the wilderness and gave them drink as out of the great depths. Clave. Oh, and please help me in my pronunciation of this, because I know your Hebrew scholars, Bill Cloud will probably laugh us right off the sofa here, but baka, to split, to divide, to move asunder,
uh-huh.
according to the Strong's that I have found. It says he split the rocks in the wilderness. That's the very same Hebrew word there, baka, that is used in Zechariah, where it says when Messiah's feet shall touch the Mount of Olives, it will cleave asunder.
Mm.
You know, it'll go one way
mm-hmm.
and the other
mm-hmm.
way. That's the very same word that's used for this rock.
Wow.
So if you find the right rock, it's not a rock with a bunch of little round fissure holes that water
mm-hmm.
might have come out of.
Mm-hmm.
It's a rock that's been divided.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's very specific, because the very next thing it says, if you'll go back to that same photograph, the next thing is it says is that he caused
53.
The waters to run down as rivers, brought streams out of the rock, caused them to run down. You have to have an elevated rock to have water run down.
Yes, you do.
But the clue here is, in Corinthians it says, the rock that followed them through the desert was Christ, Yeshua.
That's
he
right.
was the one who was there in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the most magnificent symbol of Isaiah's suffering servant, the smitten one. The one whose life poured out for
mm-hmm.
us.
Mm-hmm.
That's the perfect picture of what we see here
wow.
in this desert. So it's so much more than just, you know, does this rock look like a rock that water might have come out of? There's a picture there that we believe is yet waiting for a future people that will stand below it and recognize who that really represents.
Oh, amen.
Let's go ahead and we're going to do the last of the video roll-ins
okay.
we have called Rephidim.
In the same area that the split rock at Rephidim is found, dozens of ruins dot the landscape, including cairns, kilns, and stone furnaces. These circular formations, however, are by far the most intriguing and seem to be the oldest in the valley. Arranged with several connected together, they even have doorways and thresholds. The Amalek came to fight Israel at Rephidim. I found at least 8 sling stones among these circles in evidence of that very battle. The circles are oriented toward this ridge where we saw a brilliant light in April of 1992. Arab lore tells of a mysterious mountain of lights here called Jebel al-Nur. From Rephidim, we traveled south to the crossing site of the Red Sea. Here, we found an outstanding witness to a catastrophic event. Massive coral heads, have been ripped from their bases and thrown far up on the shore. In numerous places, bronze pieces are embedded among the coral and the twisted shells. Amazingly, this petrified formation is not found anywhere else along the entire Gulf of Aqaba. And now, to the awesome wilderness of Arabia. South of Mount Sinai, in the most uninhabitable regions of the country, artifacts can be found scattered all over the desert. The arrowheads and spear points found here are known to be of Egyptian design. Their sheer numbers prove that a vast congregation of people passed through this place. Here, you can see the delicate pressure-flaked points. Beside the arrowheads, more weaponry, such as hand axes and this bola type, have been found in abundance. Others include handheld grinders. The Bible tells us that the women ground the manna and baked it into cakes. All the way back to Rephidim now, we find petroglyphs, or stone carvings, or numerous outcroppings of rock. Perhaps the most profound of all are the feet carvings. From small to large in size, they are found all over this region. Awe-inspiring they are, for Moses told the children of Israel in Deuteronomy 11:24, "Every place whereupon the soles of your feet shall tread shall be yours."
You can see from all those leading up to the footprints, the evidence just continues to mount and continues to mount. But in the very beginning there, you saw that table full of artifacts.
Yes.
This is from a deep desert down in Saudi Arabia. This isn't from up in the northwest where the mountain is. This is in a deep southern desert of Arabia. And as we began to find these things down there, it dawned on us, what if the wandering in the wilderness, the 40 years in the wilderness, actually took place on the Arabian Peninsula, not from northwest Arabia northward, because you run into all sorts of problems there. You could put a line of 1 million people in northwest Arabia and it would reach Jerusalem. You can't wander for 40 years with that many people in that small of a space.
Uh-huh.
So we began to look at these things, but I'll come back to that in just a minute. If you can pull up that, which one is it, the 54?
Through 60.
These feet, or these footprints, are actually, we call them the footprints, but to be honest, these are soles of feet.
Uh-huh.
These are not feet with toes like mm-hmm. some sort of mm-hmm. prehistoric cave art. There's something very specific going on here, and we've seen these all over Arabia, but they are heavily concentrated up in this area by where this huge split rock is. And I just happened to have my Bible open and reading in Deuteronomy while I just happened to have our photo albums open one day, and it suddenly occurred to me, I was reading Deuteronomy 11:24. And it occurred to me, what am I looking at
That's
here?
Right.
What if these carved, sandaled footprints that are all over the rocks, and these are deeply etched, by the way,
mm-hmm.
they would have well standed 3,000 years
mm-hmm.
of time.
Mm-hmm.
What if these are the footprints of the children of Israel, according to the promise?
Uh-huh.
What if... And I remember I went screaming down the stairs and told it to Jim, and he just looked at me like I had completely lost my mind, which he probably had a right to do. But look at what it says in Deuteronomy 11:24: "Every place whereon the soles of your feet shall tread shall be yours." This was a progressive promise given. Oh, it started back with Abraham.
Yes,
arrive and walk the length and the breadth
yes,
of the land.
Did.
Well, we have it on good knowledge, living in Saudi Arabia for 12 years. They fully say that Father Ibrahim of the Quran wandered the whole Arabian Peninsula. Now, why would they have that in their own history? We found a book in one of the Islamic bookstores out of Mecca and Medina that one of their caliphs said very clearly that Moses and the children of Israel wandered through Mecca. That's way down on the western
wow.
Saudi Peninsula. So why is it in their history, but we have no concept of it?
Mm-hmm.
And we say, no, it can't be. Tradition says
mm-hmm.
it has to be up
mm-hmm.
North of the tip of the Gulf of Aqaba. All the wandering had to take place there or within the traditional Sinai. So, you know, we're looking at these various things, but the footprints become extremely important. And gosh, I wish I had time. We could teach for 10 hours on just this one subject. But there are etchings next to the footprints. I'm not at liberty to say the names of some of these experts that are working with us on this right now for their safety's sake, to be perfectly
continuing
honest.
Continuing research.
Continuing research, but there is Thamudic characters, and this is highly controversial. This is not a proven thing yet, but it's so profound, I'm quite sure it's going to be end up being proven. Sure. But next to these footprints are some etchings that were pointed out to us as being the actual a proto-Hebraic character, a Thamudic character, which related to the kaf, or which is in Hebrew the cup of the palm of the hand or the sole of the foot. So if we have a sole of a foot that's been traced on a rock, first off, the time it would take to do that, but you know, if yes, that's your promise, you inherit every place you put the sole of your foot, I can guarantee you I'd be out there etching myself on the rock. But someone actually took the time to put next to that a Thamudic character that meant the sole of the foot. So why would you have the sole of the foot plus an alpha character that says the sole of my foot was here, basically, if this does not relate to the children of Israel? That is more profound to us than even the possible location of the real Mount Sinai because of that promise, because that brings it to where we are today. Why are all these footprints all over the Arabian Peninsula, and is anyone going to recognize whose feet they really are?
Wow.
Now, if you have an idea, I've got to tell you just very quickly, we have a very, very dear friend and brother in Christ. His name is Dr. Sung-Hak Kim. I can't even begin right now with the time we have to tell you how we were connected with him and how it all worked out. But this dear gentleman was with his family, and from 2001 all the way through about 2006, he was in Saudi Arabia. He was the personal physician to one of the princes of Saudi Arabia. And long story short, he found out that this was a potential for the mountain, and the Lord led him and his family the same exact way that he did ours. Dr. Kim also says many times he takes one family from the east, he takes one family from the west to prove who he is. So he is our brother. He's so close to us. He shared something with us, and his discovery, he and his wife found something that is so profound within the vicinity. It was not right at the base of the mountain, but within the vicinity around the mountain, that's going to become the greatest discovery of our time, which proves to us who was doing the actual writing on these rocks. This is Dr. Kim. This is his photograph and his discovery. We have a covering over it, but the next photo we're going to show you, if you have any doubt as to who wrote on those rocks,
goodness,
you don't now.
Yeah.
Now, can you even imagine?
Now, that character we were showing next to the footprints is a calf. It's three lines, three straight lines. That calf fits into the ancient Thamudic language, which evolves into the ancient Hebraic. But what is being revealed here, and scholars have debated whether it's 1000 B.C., 3000 B.C., but they never get around the time of the Exodus. And what this is going to do is focus people and the scholars to look at the time of the Exodus for the origin of this Thamudic language. And a lot's going to be coming out about the origin of the language and its generation, its a conception right there at the mountain, the language being given
at
the mountain.
And what you see here is now the oldest known menorah, as opposed to the one over the Titus Arch in Rome.
Which is 200 B.C.
And Dr. 200. Kim and his wife Jenny found it there in this region. So if you really, you know, there's no doubt in my mind, before I ever saw this, who was making the etchings on these rocks and who was making those footprints. But now, what other group of peoples would have etched a menorah on the rocks? I mean, it's just as plain as day.
One other comment about Dr. Kim is he could speak fluent Arabic, which I could not. And he was able to talk to the local Bedouin. when he would go out and do these trips to look for petroglyphs and these kind of things. And he said their comment about the Thamudic language was, Yahud was here. Now, Yahud is another name for Israel to them, to the local Bedouin. Mm-hmm. So what they were saying was, the people that have put these here are the Israelis. Yahud was here. And all of these inscriptions that you're seeing were generated by them. So we're seeing a picture of the rocks in Arabia. These things cover the western portion of Arabia all the way down mm-hmm. into Yemen and on around into the eastern province.
Yeah, so we can go here next. But why is that so important? Well, it's utterly astonishing that in our day and
63.
Time, something of this magnitude would be related.
63.
You know, the world is trying to get Israel to give back most of the land that she currently has.
Mm-hmm.
And
absolutely.
When the promise is that wherever you place the soles of your feet, God will eventually give you the land, you've got a whole nother concept of just how big Israel might mm-hmm. really be mm-hmm. when you look at this.
Mm-hmm.
So, and this is the crux of what it comes down to. Where is the land of the wandering? We have to, by virtue of the fact, what did the Lord say? He said, now turn and go into the desert by the way of the Red Sea.
Next slide. Yeah, at the top what we're saying is the scripture where it says, now turn and go into the wilderness by the way of the Red Sea. And we're looking at the location of Midian up in the top left corner of the Arabian Peninsula. And then what we have is an idea that they traveled south into southern Arabia, and that the great and terrible wilderness that we see is actually what they call, the Arabians call, the Rub Akali. Now, there's some interesting information coming out about the name places in some of these southern Arabian areas. And the Rub Akali, as pointed out by Dr. Leonard Moeller, also may mean Reuben the Chaldean. So we see in the great and terrible wilderness evidence of the name of Reuben, as well as some other tribe names, the tribe of Gad and Manasseh in that region.
It's very interesting research. And back in one of those Rolands, you saw all those artifacts and that land where it's nothing but sand as far as the eye can see. We are truly there talking about a great and terrible wilderness. And if you don't have water and if you don't have the manna, you die.
Mm-hmm.
And all of those artifacts are coming out of that deep desert region. So who was it that was down there? Who wandered all the way down there? Why are there such serious and very ancient, not from the time of the Babylonian exile or the overruns of Rome, why are there thousands of years old Jewish settlements in Yemen? They've been there a lot longer than the dispersions.
Mm-hmm.
So where did that originate? One of the things that is closely being followed, besides the fact that we've got the evidence of the footprints, this language that's written on these rocks that the menorah testifies to, shall we say, also follows this pathway all the way down the Arabian Peninsula and over into the southeastern areas of Arabia. Why is this language being written on the rocks all the way down? You know what the Lord's command was? He said, I'm giving you this. Here mm-hmm. at Sinai, you teach it to your children. You write it on your doorposts.
Mm-hmm.
You write it. You mm-hmm. teach them this is the covenant. You teach them these things. And mm-hmm. this language gets more and more prolific on the rocks the farther south you go.
Really?
So we have this amazing story of the alphabet going down the peninsula and getting more and more refined as it does and looking more and more like Proto-Hebraic. Then this very thing right here, every place where on the soles of the where on the soles of your feet shall tread shall be yours. Go to the next slide.
The next slide. There we go.
Look where the footprint go.
Oh.
There is evidence that the footprints, they've been seen in deep South Arabia, they've been seen in the eastern province of Saudi Arabia, they've been seen up and around the curve of Arabia to the north along the Euphrates, and they've been seen all over the land of Midian. So are we having a picture that's beginning to form here of where the wandering in the wilderness really took place? The great and terrible wilderness, let me assure you, we've crisscrossed Saudi Arabia time and time again, and it is a great and terrible wilderness. And you could easily lose 1 million-plus people in this vast continent
mm-hmm.
for the length of time the Scripture says mm-hmm. that they will. But this is one of the most profound things ever. And I tell you what, we have to credit Dr. Leonard Moeller for coming up with some things that are just astonishing. They really are. When we first began to speak with him in early 2000s about, Jim and I just are determined because of what we've seen, the whole of the Arabian Peninsula is where the wandering in the wilderness took place. Because you see, when you get the mountain in the right place, then everything else opens up to you.
Mm-hmm.
So we were telling him about these things, and I think he thought we were insane at the beginning. But he is quite an extensive research scientist. And you know, he's not going to go out on a whim just because Jim and I think something might be. Mm-hmm. He went home and did a great amount of study. He happens to have some very ancient maps, particularly one that was in French. And let's see, which was the number of that slide?
Same slide, back up.
We'll pull that back up here, and I'll show you some of the things that he has found. Over in the right-hand side, you'll see People de Gad. That in French is the people of Gad. Why is this ancient French map have the people of Gad locating in what is now current day Oman? And if you look just a little bit north of that, there's something profound. You'll see a green star that says Asher. Well, guess where that Asher is? That's where we lived in the eastern province of Saudi Arabia, and
yeah.
That's where the major oil fields are. What does the book say?
Dip in the toe
dip
of
your
Asher.
Toe. Asher shall Asher dip oil. His foot in oil. It's the blessing of Jacob upon his sons. What is Asher doing? But, of course, in modern-day maps, you don't find any of this.
Oh, absolutely.
And Dr. Moeller is the one who found these. This is where he found, what if Rub al-Khali in Arabic means the empty quarter. But how closely does this sound to Reuben the Chaldean, Rub de Calais? Rub de Calais. What, and who took their inheritance in the wilderness? Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. Why do we find on an ancient French map Gad and Reuben? Highly possible. But the mind-blower was this. Down at the tip of the Red Sea down there, you'll see in the bottom mm-hmm. central, Ras Israel.
What?
Uh-huh. Head of Israel.
Uh-huh.
Down there located in what is now Yemen. Why would, who in their right mind in current day would name something Ras Israel? Arabic Ras is the same as Hebrew Rosh, head of, beginning of. What is a something called the beginning of Israel or the head of Israel doing all the way down in Yemen? And why don't you find it on any current maps? Something is going on here.
History rewritten.
Mm-hmm. Something is going on here.
And one of the other things about that map was that all of the red stars that you see, and there were many, are things that in our research we have collected together as possible matches to biblical sites. Mm-hmm. Other people have gone out and said, yes, Uber is in Arabia. Gerar, some of these other cities, they've identified them. The archaeologists have said they're possible sites. So all of those are marked on there as well. And you can bring that slide back up just one more time. But I wanted to point out that where the blue stars are, you see, are around the mountain. And mm-hmm. back at when Emmanuel Anati was put together his Adena kit, he said, this is what you should find. 28 of those stars are piled up on top of each other as things that we have seen about the mountain in character, artifacts, mm-hmm. all the other information, 28 of those things piled up together as possible matches to the Bible. We believe very closely and that they are our exact masses, but again, we have to leave it for interpretation. So that's an overview of what we think this moving Mount Sinai into the Arabian Peninsula, what this does and how it explodes this idea of wandering in the wilderness and a march straight north mm-hmm. from Sinai, because they're not captured by the Gulf of Aqaba anymore, forced north. Now they're free to go in any direction, north, east, and south. And south mm-hmm. is the direction we believe they went into.
Where does the Rock of Mecca come into this? It has to play something in there.
We do a presentation yeah. where we go from all of these things. There's so much information here. And when we get into this section, that comes up, but I would dare not give it away in this
We have such a short space of time
to get to it and really develop that idea.
One of our Jewish friends really said something about that.
But you see it, yes. Yep. And you see that is where, we have a connection, a real close connection.
And our dear friend Avi Lipkin, Avi
was the one.
This is why we had quite a night that night that we spent. Avi was staying at our home with us, and we kept explaining to him, Jim has some very strong evidence of just how and where that whole box, whole building, the Kaaba,
the origin
has
of the Kaaba.
Very, very close ties, we
he
do believe.
He must have been there this spring because he came here with this in his mind.
He did. He was with us like in March or so, and it was shortly thereafter he was here on this program.
Said we had re-energized his fervor about this idea because he had this in seminary years ago when he was studying, and he had a thought about it. But when we presented our material and I showed him some of the things that we believe, it
connected
really
to him. He believes very strongly, and I know he shared this with you, that the phylacteries, which are perfect little black boxes, they are a perfect copy of the covered building there, the Kaaba. So there is a very strong connection to the wandering in the wilderness and that very thing. We're going to have to leave that for another time.
Off air, we can have a discussion about
when it all comes down, it's all coming to a head.
Yes,
it is. This is being revealed in this day and age for just such
time. That's exactly right. And you know what? This opens up a mass amount of possibilities. And I'm just going to go ahead and throw out a couple of these. Because in our hearts and minds, we're sure of it. What happened to Paul on the road to Damascus? The Lord appeared to him.
Blinding revelation.
He had a blinding revelation. And it says shortly after there, a very amazing thing. After he received his sight, he didn't go up to Jerusalem or to them that were before, but the Spirit drove him where? Into Arabia. You want to guess where we think he went?
Where?
He went straight to Mount Sinai.
Yes.
And look at the correlation between Hagar and Sarah, between Zion and Sinai, between a mountain you can't touch and a mountain that the grace of God has fallen on. Why that great student of Gamaliel, where would he go? Why would the Spirit drive him directly into Arabia? Because, I think he wrote the whole book of Galatians from the cave. You know, that cave up there that's quite possibly Elijah's cave. Mm-hmm. Because he had such a beautiful understanding of the two covenants, of the you can say it in that manner, but everything that he wrote, this Hagar is Sinai in Arabia. If the Spirit drove him into Arabia and gave him such understanding of how everything fit, surely that's where he went. And I'll tell you another one. What about Elijah? What about Elijah? 1 Kings 19, it says, it was just after the Carmel incident where he called down fire on the prophets of Baal, and he runs, first off, he goes and hides under a tree and wants to die, and no, that's not what the plan was. So 40 days and 40 nights later, he's fasting in the strength of the two cakes and goes to Horeb, Mountain of God.
Oh, wow.
And goes into a cave. Mm-hmm. And we think we know right where the cave is. We showed it to you earlier. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But also, who else was at that mountain? Moses. Moses was at that mountain. Elijah was at that mountain. What about when Jesus took Peter, James, and John to a high mountain far apart, and he was transfigured before them? Wow. Who appeared? Moses
and Elijah.
And Elijah. You know, he said, I came to fulfill the law.
Yeah.
What if he really stood there where it was given? What if Mount Sinai is the Mount of Transfiguration?
Why not?
Doesn't it make sense?
Mm. It does.
Yeah. It makes sense.
And I'll tell you another one that's a mind-boggling thought. And, all of this is open to complete interpretation and debate, and we could be completely wrong in all of this, but it's things that we do ponder. What about Jacob? Jacob has this marvelous encounter where he sees a ladder. He sees a stairway. You know, he goes to sleep and he dreams, and he sees the angels of God ascending and descending mm-hmm. upon this staircase. Mm-hmm. And he says, whoa, this is none other than the gate of heaven mm-hmm. and the house of God. Mm-hmm. And he called it Beit El, mm-hmm. the house of God. But the name of that place before was Luz.
What?
Luz.
Jebel Luz. This mountain.
It doesn't say Jebel Luz, but it says the name of that place before was Luz or Laws. What is this mountain's name in Arabia? Laws. What happened? You know, when God descended in fire on that mountain, you can call it the portal of heaven because he took Moses up there and he showed him the pattern. He mm-hmm. showed him the heavenly pattern. There was absolutely a corridor, a portal, whatever you want to say, there for God to come down and for Moses to see the heavenly mm-hmm. ark and the heavenly menorah mm-hmm. and such as that. Jacob had an encounter at a place that was once called Laws that he renamed Beit El, Bethel. Mm-hmm. He renamed it that because he said this, because there's a stairway. Angels are coming up and down here. You know, in the Psalms it says many myriads of angels accompanied God there at Sinai. They were moving up and down over yes. the mountain. Yes. What if these are the same places? What if? Another very interesting thing. The name Rephidim, and you know, I am certainly not a Hebrew scholar under any circumstance, but in the Strong's Concordance and in the Hebrew Chaldee dictionary that I have, one of the first names of Rephidim means the balustrade or the staircase. You know, the balusters mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Of a rail, mm-hmm. of a stair. Mm-hmm. Why would you... That's kind of a really odd name. The place yeah. where the rock was split and the waters came forth is called Rephidim. Why is it named the staircase? Or not the staircase, but the balustrade. Uh-huh. The balustrade. Why would you name a place where water was released as the balustrade? What if that's the area that Jacob had the dream? The balustrade. The only place in Scripture that I know that a ladder to heaven is spoken of. Uh-huh. So, like I said, these things are just thoughts to ponder. I may be completely far out and off the wall, but there are certainly, like I said, once you move this mountain into this area, all sorts of things open up that we had never even thought of as possibilities before. The bottom line is, there's something in Arabia that's been actively hidden on purpose for generations. Only a few people in this day and time have come out and started looking at this as a real possibility. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But the bottom line is, why would God do this in our hour in which we live? Now, there's one thing I do have to say, and I want to say that there is a movie that will be coming. Avi Lipkin spoke of this. He said he had a look at this, and it changed his life. Wow. Well, there is a movie that is coming. It's called The Exodus Conspiracy. You can go to one of the most beautiful websites out there, and it's www.exodusconspiracy.com. This movie will be released in Israel first, and then it will come to the rest of the United States, and we hope it will be early next year. Hope. I can't tell you exactly when it's going to be released because it's not quite completed. But this is the largest gathering of professionals, archaeologists, Egyptologists, geologists, geographers, heads of museums, people, theologians. One, Mr. Tim Mahoney, who is also a dear friend, is the filmmaker, and it's out of Mahoney Media Group in Minneapolis. And they are taking a look at all these various things, a lot of which you've seen this evening. But Tim even takes it further. And it's an absolutely astonishing film, so I would encourage everyone to go to that website and monitor it for when this film is going to come out, because, like I said, Jim and I are not experts. At best, we're ground proofers. We went in and snuck a bunch of pictures and you
somebody
know...
Somebody said...
Eyewitnesses.
Exodus, what's the website again?
It's exodusconspiracy.com.
Okay, thank you, crew.
And you can have a look at that, and please monitor it, because this film is absolutely going to turn the world upside down with some of these things.
Oh, wow.
It, you know, just by virtue of its length, it can't go into great detail, like some of what you've seen tonight, but I can guarantee you it is eye-popping. And at the end of the day, everyone should know, yes, there is a God in heaven, and yes, he is the God of Israel.
You know, you
God of Covenant.
Talk
yes.
a very small part about your book. What's in the rest of your book?
Well, that book is actually, because so many people have heard about various people who have been out to this mountain or whatever, and they want to know, how are we connected to it? Where, you know, where did you get involved in this? And that's why I wrote the book. I wrote it, and I'm telling you, you'll know what we ate, you'll know what we drank. It's right off my journals. I wrote a journal throughout this whole journey.
It's wonderful.
And, you know, in some ways, it's probably very silly, but in other ways, you will see the profound with the mundane. We were just a family out on an adventure that turned out really to be an adventure, and it wound us up through this crazy trip through Egypt, going through things that normal families go through. You know, the kids fighting in the back seat and me threatening to throw them out the truck half the time going down the road. But then the very next scene you'll read about is us falling to our knees at the base of a mountain that we believe God himself descended in flames of a fire. And as you get toward the end of the book, those things start becoming very aware, and you will know, just like we did, that we were led out truly by a vision of God. There's no other way to explain it. And it's not that we're anybody special. It's just that there is a very special God of that mountain and of all creation.
Wow.
And he's got something to say in our day and time.
He does. Wow, I can't wait to see what the world reaction is when that movie comes out. And that expose of the truth that lies in Saudi Arabia.
And it's not a fairy tale made up by a bunch of crazy Jews.
That's exactly right. You know, I was thinking about those scriptures. I believe it's in either 1st or 2nd Peter, where he says, we are not following cunningly devised fairy tales here.
Right.
We are speaking to you of what we have seen and touched with our own eyes, the Word of God, living, breathing here among us, Yeshua, Lord. And it just... That's what these things are all about. As I've said before, the archaeology is stunning enough if it proves out to be these things. But come on. I mean, you've got like 45 points that are possible matches without even getting into the other things that are non-archaeological, like quail and almond trees and
big trees.
And, you know, and you look at all of these things, and when you take them all together, I mean, isn't that what science does? It takes all of the possibilities and puts them all together and looks at the percentages. And, you know, three witnesses can convict a man, well, 12 in our country, but 12 can convict a man to life or death. How many points do we have to show? And let me assure you, when we do our presentations in churches and such, we or anywhere else, we'll do them for one person in a back room or in front of 15,000 people. I don't care. Wherever we can speak, we will. But we have
so
many.
Get a hold of you by your website. Would you guys leave that website up?
Yes. In fact, all the information of how to contact us and how to have us come speak, should you so desire, is out there on the website. But, you know, we only brought a tiny little handful.
Split rock. Split rock because
research.
Of that big rock.
Because of the rock at heart.
Oh,
yes.
Boy.
Yeah.
Split rock research.
One of the things that we try to do when we do our fast presentation, which still takes a couple of hours, sometimes two and a half, is that we try to bring it to you as an experience. We want you to come with us. We want you to take this journey with us. You're going to see a lot of video. You're going to be hit with a lot of images, because we also want to make that impression of how powerful this is and how real it is. But we also want you to have a good time with us and see some of the snowflakes in the desert and hear the kids screaming. And so we kind of mix it up with the things right out of the book, as well as the archaeology and the physical evidence.
Star of David Snowflake.
Star of David Snowflake, yeah, and you can actually see that video. Jim was right. I thought we had it with us, but it is on our website. You can go and click on it, and you can see these little Star of David Snowflakes. But one of the things I want to tell you, and we can get into this kind of little detail when we are in our presentations, but One of the hilarious things, you know how here is Dr. Leonard Moeller in Sweden, born on exactly the same day that Jim Caldwell is born in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, whose destinies in the Lord meet out over the sands of Saudi Arabia. Uh-huh. Only God can do something like that. Mm-hmm. But get this, the family from the East, Dr. Kim and his wife, Jenny, Jim and Penny, Kim and Jenny. We had the same experience
about that
in Saudi Arabia. He took his children just like we took our children. They went 12 times to the mountain. So, you know, it just, those little check marks
things
that God gives you as you go along are just what has kept this so alive in us all these years. And it just gets more dear to us as the years go by.
You told us your children were what? 10 and 7.
They were 7 and 9 on the first trip.
7 and 9.
7 and 9.
And now they are
27 and 24.
Wow.
So they're grown.
2 years have gone by.
They're grown now.
How many trips to the mountain did they make with you?
Probably 6 or mm-hmm. 7. We didn't take them on the high mountain climbs because it was just too dangerous.
They couldn't have done that.
But let me tell you, they were incredible troopers, and they wish they could go back to this day. In fact, the Saudi Arabia is home to them.
I bet it is.
It really, you want to know the truth? Having had these experiences, that place is home to us.
That's where you'd like to be.
That's where we'd like to be. And may end up back again someday along with others, but that's a whole nother show.
Well, Tommy, you scheduled this excellent program. I'm going to let you close it out the way you'd like to.
I just thank you so much for coming and sharing this tidbit with us, because there is so much more. And you do want to get the book, and you do want to follow along on the website and see how things progress, because this is going to be monumental in history.
And thanks for bringing it to GLC. And keep praying for the peace of Jerusalem.
And so the wicked man fled when no man pursued him. But the righteous are bold as a lion. I saw the humble lion bold like a lion. Cause him got to enter Mount Zion. The rich man is wise to his own conceit. But the poor man that overstandeth search him out. When righteous men do rejoice, there is great glory. But when the wicked rise, someone goes into hiding. And with Jack come forth all week, our child's bad. Yeah. So all Babylon say that all Rastaman got to flee. About the high and I know say all of Babylon and Baalet got to get down on their knee. Then go to run to the sea. I saw them get down on their knee. I say a them I go flee. Flee! Flee! Ah. I saw it dead.
This program is brought to you exclusively by the love gifts and offerings of our faithful partners. Thank you, partners.